أني أحمل فوق رأسي خبزا تأكل الطير منه نبئنا بتأويله إنا نراك من المحسنين. صدق الله العظيم. Respected brothers, elders, young friends, and honorable listeners, we continue with the tafsir, the exegesis of this amazing and this riveting tale of the great Prophet of Allah, Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. We mentioned in the last session how Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, his test was getting even more difficult. First, it was one woman trying to seduce Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, and he resisted, and Allah Ta'ala saved him. And Allah Ta'ala also proves his innocence in the Quran, and then a witness came forward in the form of a baby in the cradle and gave testimony in favor of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. Thereafter, we mentioned that Zulaykha, she prepared a meal and she called these other women of the city to expose them to the beauty of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. When they see the beauty of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, then when they were cutting away at the knife, they cut into their fingers. And then she tells him and she threatens Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam that next time if he does not oblige, if you do not oblige, then Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam will be incarcerated and he will be imprisoned. So she gives this threat in front of these women. Now, these women also now start to, they change their stance and they are in favor of Zulaykha. And they start to say to Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam that, oh Yusuf, why don't you oblige? Why don't you listen? She's being kind to you. You should fulfill her desires. So now this test was getting really, really difficult for Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. And he makes a dua to Allah Ta'ala. He implores Allah Ta'ala that, Ya Allah, the sijn and the prison is more dear to me than this, what they call me towards, i.e. zina. وَإِلَّا تَصْرِفْ. And then the humility of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, he says, Ya Allah, if you do not avert from me their plotting, then humanly I'm going to incline. He didn't rely upon his ismat that, you know, I am a Nabi, I am ma'soom, nothing is going to happen to me. He didn't rely on that. And we mentioned how we are not, you know, ma'soom, and we, you know, in any situation, we always have to ask from Allah Ta'ala to save us from these situations and from these sins. And we mentioned regarding the dua of afiyat, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-afiyat, one of the best duas that we can ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then, now moving on into verse 34 of Surah Yusuf. Now it's a new turn for Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam, where he enters into the prison. He enters into the prison. So he's in this place. He's in this place, obviously, where criminals are kept. But he's not in sin. And as long as you are not in sin, then you are at peace with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now look at this new development in the life of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Allah Ta'ala says, وَدَخَلَ مَعَهُ السِّجْنَ فَتَيَانَ. When Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he arrived at the prison, then there were two youngsters who also entered into the prison at the same time of Sayyiduna Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So his entry into prison coincided with the entry of two other youngsters. Now, historical narration suggests that both of these individuals, they were officers of the king of the time, Riyan ibn al-Walid. One was Saqiyul Malik and one was the Khabbas. So one was the wine bearer. He would prepare the drink, he would prepare the wine for the king. And the other one was the Khabbas, so he would prepare the bread and he would prepare the food for the king. Now both of these individuals, they were accused of trying to poison the king. Hence the case was still active and it was still under investigation. So in the meantime, both of them were sent into the prison. Now in one of the tafasir is mentioned that there was a parliamentary group. And this group, they had dislike for the king. And they wanted to have the king killed. Now they realized that these two individuals, the Saqiyul Malik and the Khabbaz, the wine bearer and the one who prepares the bread for the king, obviously, they are very close to the king. They have the meal with the king. They even prepare the food for the king. Hence, if they wanted to get someone to poison the food, it will be these two. So they promise these two individuals huge rewards if they can poison the food and the drink of the king. So both of them agreed to do it. Then later on, the wine bearer, he felt guilty, and he mentions fanadima, and he had regret and remorse, and he didn't accept the money. But the khabbaz, the one who would prepare the bread for the king, he accepted the money, and he went and poisoned the food of the king and the bread of the king. Now, when the king came to sit down, the wine bearer is sitting, and the khabbaz and the bread maker, and he is sitting there, and now they are about to eat. The king is about to eat. When the wine bearer, he says to the king, that لا تأكل أيها الملك فإن الطعام مسموم, that, oh dear king, do not eat from the food, it's been poisoned. So then, the person who had actually poisoned the food, he says to the king, that لا تشرب فإن الشراب مسموم, that, oh dear king, do not drink because the sharab and the drink has been poisoned. So now the king, he was confused at what's happening here. So he says to the wine bearer, you drink from the drink, ishrab. So he drinks, فَشَرِبَهُ فَلَمْ يَضُرَّهُ شَيْئًا, nothing happens to him because he wasn't poisoned. And then he says to the person who was preparing his food, he says to him that you eat from it, فَأَبَى, and he refuses to eat. فَأُطْعِمَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ الطَّعَامْ دَابَّةً فَهَلَكَتْ, then that same food was then fed to an animal which died immediately. So then the king, he got quite angry, and then he put them into the prison, and this case was under investigation. Now, we'll see how this paves the way for Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam later on to get onto the throne. But this is the, you know, this is how Allah Ta'ala works. Allah Ta'ala works in mysterious ways, and Allah Ta'ala works in amazing ways. Now, the Quran doesn't go into the intricate details how Yusuf alayhi salam got there, who he was escorted by, in what cell he was. No, the Quran goes directly to the point of guidance and directly to the point of hidayah. Now, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam in the prison, in the jail, he was known for as a man of honesty, as a man of truthfulness, as a man of good morals and good character. And he was known as a man of who would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he was also known as a person, as a man who could interpret dreams. So these two individuals, like I mentioned, they entered into the prison around the same time of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. They drew very close to Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And they both came to Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and they relate to him that we've seen a vision, we've seen a dream. Now in that time, the Egyptians, they would give much importance to dreams. So they come and they say, وَدَخَلَ مَعَهُ السِّجْنَ فَتَيَانِ قَالَ أَحَدُهُمَا إِنِّي أَرَانِي أَعْصِرُ خَمْرًا. So the first person, the first one of them, he says that I've seen a dream, that in the dream I am pressing wine, I am squeezing. So أَعْصِر means to squeeze, أَعْصِرُ خَمْرًا meaning from grapes, I am squeezing and I'm making alcohol. إِنِّي أَرَانِي أَعْصِرُ خَمْرًا. وَقَالَ الْآخِرُ, and the second one says, إِنِّي أَرَانِي أَحْمِلُ فَوْقَ رَأْسِي خُبْزًا تَأْكُلُ الطَّيْرُ مِنْ, that I see myself carrying bread on my head. Carrying bread on my head, تَأْكُلُ الطَّيْرُ, and birds are coming and they're pecking away and they're eating away at this bread. نَبِّئْنَا بِتَأْوِيلِ, tell us of the interpretation of this dream. Please narrate to us the interpretation of this dream. Now can you imagine Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he's just entered the prison. You know, so much has happened in his life. If it was any of us, we'd be like, you know, I need a moment. I need some me time. Give me some space. But no sooner does Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam enter into the prison, by virtue of his good character, he has a profound impression on his fellow inmates, that they say to him, "Inna naraka min al muhsinin," we see you to be a kind person. We see you of a person with good attributes. And this is why later on as well, when he's on the throne, when he's a king, his brothers come to him and they don't know who he is. And they say, قَالُوا يَا أَيُّهَا الْمَلِكُ, there's a verse and he says, إِنَّا نَرَاكَ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, the brothers also say to him that we see you, that you are a kind man. And that is a kind man, whether he's in the jail, whether he's on the throne. You know, it's easy to be a kind person when you're unknown, but when you're a prominent figure in the society, then how many of us can have that same attitude? It's very, very difficult. So, إِنَّا نَرَاكَ مِنَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, we see that you have good attributes and we see that you are a kind person. Dhahak rahimahullah ta'ala was asked that what were his good attributes. So he mentions that in the prison, when a prisoner would fall ill, would become sick, then Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam would go visit him, would treat him. when a person was going through some kind of hardship, when a person was going through some kind of difficulty, then Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam would go and help him out. When a person was in need, then Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam would gather some money for that individual and help him out. And not only that, he would lift the spirits of people, and he would sacrifice his own comfort, you know, for the comfort of others. And beyond that, he would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's mentioned that he would fast throughout the days, and during the nights he would observe the tahajjud prayer. And it's also mentioned in the historical narrations that even the prison guard became very fond of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, to the extent that he says to him that if it was in my power, if it was in my control, then I would let you go. But as long as you are here, I will be kind to you and I will look after you. And it's mentioned in Ibn Kathir as well that when these two individuals, they came to Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, they came and they said that by Allah Ta'ala, wallah, we have great love for you. You know, just by virtue of his character, just by virtue of his good morals. So Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam replies that may Allah Ta'ala gift you with barakah, may Allah Ta'ala grant you prosperity. But remember this, whoever has loved me has brought grief to me. My aunt loved me and she harmed, because of her I was harmed. My father loved me and because of his love, I was thrown into the well. And then the minister's wife, she loved me and because of her I'm here, I'm in the prison. So then these two individuals reply that by Allah, we have no control over anything in relation to your love. So now these individuals, they've entered the prison. Now they are oblivious of the history of Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and they've come to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam with a need, with a hajat. And Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he realizes that this is an ideal moment. This is why it's written that inna sahib al hajati yuti'u wa yasma', inna sahib al hajati yakhda' wa yasma', falaw qultu lahuma shay'an lasami'a wa sami'a ahlu sijn. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he realized that these individuals, they are desperate. They want to know something. And if I was to say something to them, then they will listen, they will be attentive, they will be all ears, they will want to listen. And even the people of the prison will listen, because they're confused, they've had this dream. So at this time, this is the perfect moment to strike. This is the perfect moment to strike. And this is what this is a great lesson that we learn from here. You know, sometimes a child comes to you, maybe your own child comes to you and says, "But you know, I want to go out with my friends, or I want this much money." Then that is an ideal moment at that time. Oh, I want some sweets. Okay, he comes to you and I want some sweets, or I want to go out. That is an ideal moment for you now. You've got that child there and you say to him, I'll give it to you, I'll give you the money, I'll give you the sweets, I'll let you go out, but listen to me for a second. At that time, that child will be all ears. He'll be listening and he will listen to anything that you say at that time. As soon as you give him that sweet, he will be gone and you won't be, you know, that's it, you've lost them. Likewise, here Sayyidina Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he realized that these individuals, they've come and they are desperate, they've come with a need. This is the ideal moment to strike. So what does he do? He uses this moment to communicate tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a da'i. A da'i is one who invites to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a da'i, he uses every moment of khair and he exploits it. And this was Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was khairul muallim. He was the best of teachers. He was the best of humans. And if you look at the life of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and how he would exploit every single moment to communicate tawheed, monotheism, and the doctrine of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's so many examples if you look into the seerah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You know, on one occasion, the Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum, they are traveling. And this is what I mean, that when we have that moment, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he realized, I've got a moment here, I've got them here, they're all ears, perfect moment to strike, perfect moment to communicate tawheed. So, Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, they are traveling, and they pass by a carcass, and it was giving off a very, very strong stench. And the nose had been severed and the ears had been chopped off. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, when they passed by it, then they blocked their noses and they hastened their pace. Obviously because of the stench and because of the smell that was coming out of it. And obviously they showed repugnance towards it and they showed dislikeness towards it. So Nabi Sallam, he realized this. So what did Nabi Sallam do? He asked, "Oh my Sahaba, who would like to buy this carcass for me? For one dirham?" So Sahaba radiallahu anhum are like, "Ya Rasulullah, we wouldn't even take it for free." So look, Nabi Sallam utilizes that opportunity. He says, that the world has less value in the sight of Allah Ta'ala than this carcass has in your eyes. Strike at the right moment. Utilize that opportunity for tawheed, for the oneness of Allah Ta'ala. And look how Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam utilized it. You know, once the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were all sat. And it was the 14th moon. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were amazed and they were marveling at the beauty of the moon. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he sees this and he says that, "O my Sahaba, just as you marvel at the moon from your respective locations, on the day of judgment, you will be blessed with the blessed countenance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this very same way." See how Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam communicates his message. Amazing. And I'll end on this incident where once it was an expedition, the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum were in one of the campaigns, and a woman, she had lost sight of her child in this campaign. And she was running up and down frantically looking for her child. Looking for her child, she's looking for her child. You know, you know what a mother feels like when she loses the child. And then later on they are paired together and she cuddles the child as a warm embrace. And that is a motherly love. That is motherly love. You know, sometimes you're in the airport or sometimes you're in the, you know, you're in the supermarket and you lose your child. You know, a person is going crazy, like, "Where's my child gone?" And, you know, I can remember just a month or two ago when one of the brothers, he thought he had lost his child in the streets. And I remember speaking to him 2 days later and he was still in tears. "He was up, I was making this dua, you know, I could not lose my child." And that is the love that a father has for the child. That is the love that a mother has for the child. So when this mother and this child, they were paired together, then it was a very emotional moment. Tears were trickling down. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he realized the emotions of the Sahaba here and he utilized that moment. And he says to the Sahaba, "O my Sahaba, atarawna hadhihi al-mar'a tarihatan waladaha fi an-nar." "O my dear Sahaba, do you think this woman would ever abandon her child and hurl this child into the flame?" He said, "Ya Rasulullah, no chance. The display of motherhood by this woman was just amazing." So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam utilizes that moment and he says, "Lallahu arhamu bi'ibadihi min hadhihi biwaladiha." Allah Ta'ala has more love for his servants than this mother has for the child. So Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam utilized these moments. And this is how, in this moment, Sayyiduna Yusuf Alayhi Salatu Wasalam, he realized that these individuals, they have come to me, they want to know this dream. But before I interpret that dream, I'm going to communicate Tawheed. So we will see in our next session how Sayyiduna Yusuf Alayhi Salatu Wasalam, with wisdom, he communicates the monotheism and the doctrine of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also he also displays one of his mu'jizat and one of his amazing miracles. We'll see how he does this in the next session. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, first of all, give me and all of us the tawfiq to do amal. May Allah ta'ala make us true da'is towards the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. سبحان الله بحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب